far too often are the Vikings of the West given all the spotlight. Well known are the stories of the raid on Lindisfarne, the siege of Paris, and the Danelaw. Less known are the Viking exploits in the East, despite them being much more dynamic, colorful, but perhaps also because they are so complicated. The Vikings of the East were primarily traders, but of a violent sort, and of a complex, multicultural background. They were Scandinavians, Slavs, and Finns, who together adapted a shared and wholly different identity inspired by the Turkic nomads of the steppe. They served the Khazar Khaganate as warriors and merchants, and were often understood by Muslim visitors as a type of Turk. To the Muslims, they were the Rus. The video has to be prefaced by a brief explanation of the word Rus, because it always causes a lot of controversy. This incredibly simple, three-phoned word, which appears almost universally to mean wholly different things, has many purported origins. Some believe it is an eastward migration of the Swedish region of Ruden. Swedes are called Rotsi by Finns, and this would then have become Rus. Others say it stems from the Roxolani, and was an ancient Slavic term. It may have originated entirely among the Byzantines and Arabs. The Bible mentions a northern people called Rosh, and they often used biblical references in describing the region. The north was called the land of Gog and Magog, the grandsons of Noah. The name might have been bestowed by the Turks. Urush, in Old Turkic, seems to be related to the Chuvash and Hungarian words for Russian, and originally meant they who fight among themselves. People get incredibly fixated on something which we will never know for certain. To the Arabs, the origins of Rus did not matter. To them, Rus were different but also part of the Sakaliba, a collective term for white Europeans. They were an itinerant upper class of violent merchants, whose only importance to the Caliphate was that they delivered luxury goods, slaves, Frankish swords, and pelts. It was from this lens that the Arabs described the Rus, the strange, multicultural Vikings of the East. Since the Muslim riders never visited the Rus' homeland, wherever it was, and only ever saw them on their travels, their descriptions of Rus' customs and culture should not be taken as a guide for any domestic culture in the Rus' homeland, or of the Slavs, Finns, or Scandinavians. The Rus appear to have been influenced by all of them, were most likely multi-ethnic, and during their travels within Khazaria they likely adapted its shared, semi-Turkic identity to blend in and form a sort of kinship with each other and the Turks. Kinda like how you might act different in the workplace and at home. This is especially true for anyone that's been in the armed forces. I never spoke to my squadmates as I did to my mother, God forbid, nor did I wear the same clothes, eat the same food, or have the same routines. Going on the Östervegur was likely the same thing, and when the travelers returned home, they likely shedded this Eastern identity, how a snake does its skin. A good starting point of learning the Rus' culture comes through one of their funerals, described in the famous account of Ahmad ibn Fadlan. This account is heavily misunderstood, as we'll come to find out. Anyway, the mindset of a people can be reflected through their rituals. Most prominently, a violent people tend to engage in violent rituals, and the Rus' burial reflected many such tendencies, along with others. Firstly, Ibn Fadlan describes how the burials differ between the poor and the wealthy. In the case of a poor man, they make a small boat for him, place him inside, and burn it. In the case of a rich man, they gather together his possessions and divide him into three portions. One for his household, one with which to cut funeral garments for him, and one with which they ferment alcohol, which they then drink on a day when his slave girl kills herself and is burned together with her master. Ibn Fadlan describes next how the slave girl is selected. The process is voluntary, and though boys could volunteer, it was usually girls that offered themselves. From the moment of her decision to the end of the ceremony, she is attended by slaves who wash her feet and participates in drinking and singing. On the day of the ritual, the chieftain's ship has been beached and placed on a huge pile of wood. The inside of the boat has been dressed with a couch covered with Byzantine silk and cushions. The supervisor of the ceremony, according to Ibn Fadlan, was a corpulent middle-aged woman whom he called the Angel of Death. Next, the chieftain is dressed in trousers, leggings, boots, a tunic, and a silk kaftan with golden buttons, and on his head, a peaked silk cap fringed with black fur. He is then carried inside of a tent raised on the ship and laid upon the cushions. Here they also lay offerings of alcohol, fruit, and sweet basil, bread, meat, and onions. They killed a dog and cut it in two, and all of his weaponry. They made two horses gallop until exhausted, and offered them next. Then two cows, a cock, and a hen. Meanwhile, inside of the tent, all of the chieftain's followers have sex with the slave girl. This orgy marks the final phase of the funerary rite. The slave girl is lifted up three times. The first time, she says, "Behold, I see my father and my mother." The second time, "Behold, I see all of my dead kindred seated." The third time, "Behold, I see my master seated in paradise. Paradise is beautiful and verdant. He is accompanied by his men and his retainers. He summons me, so bring me to him." They then brought her toward a ship, and she removed her two bracelets and passed them to the angel of death. She then removed her anklets and gave them to the two slave girls that attended her. These were the daughters of the angel of death. She was then lifted inside of the ship, but not the tent. The men gave her a beaker of alcohol, from which she drank, to bid all of her female comrades farewell. After this, she drank a second time and began chanting. The crone grabbed hold of her head and led her inside of the tent. The men started pounding their shields so that the girl could not be heard screaming. This was done as to not terrify the other slave girls and prevent them from offering themselves at future ceremonies. Six men entered a tent and had intercourse with a slave girl. Then they laid her down by the master and seized her by her hands and feet. While two of the men strangled the slave, the crone stabbed the girl with a dagger, all of this until she died. After the execution, the men and the crone exited the ship, which was ignited by a naked man walking backwards, holding the torch in one hand and covering his anus with the other. After the ship had been burned to ash, a mound was erected where it had stood. The name of the chieftain and the name of the king of the Rus was written on a piece of wood and placed on the mound. This funeral has often been interpreted as a typical Scandinavian burial of the Odinist cult, but it really shouldn't be, because only a few of its features are emblematic of Scandinavian funerals. The crone should not be likened to a Valkyrie. The angel of death description applied by Fadlan came from the Quran. A similar procedure was sort of described by Snorri Sturluson in the 13th century. Human sacrifice during Swedish blot feasts were described by Adam of Bremen a few hundred years earlier. In southern Norway, two women were discovered to have been buried inside of a ship, along with various offerings. And that's about where these specifically Nordic comparisons end. The mound and the pyre were constructed with wood, whereas Scandinavian mounds were built with stone. Wooden mounds were instead typical among the Finns and Slavs. However, this might have been due to the scarcity of stones in the region compared to wood, whereas Scandinavia is quite rich with stones. It might have been a simple local adaptation, or a cultural one. Burning the slave girl also appears to be derived from a Slavic tradition, in which widows were burned. Ibn-rustah likewise described how the Slavs cremate their dead. There is also the presence of basil. It did not appear in Scandinavia until the 16th century, and would not have been part of Germanic ceremonies in the Viking Age. It seems likelier to have been a custom from the East. Then there are the elements which are most likely Turkic. The strangulation of the girl during the sacrifice appears similar to a nomadic tradition of near strangling a future Khagan. It also appears as though nomads put their deceased chieftain in a tent to lie for 10 days while the preparation took place, similar to the Rus chieftain. Another common custom was to exhaust horses before they were sacrificed. Certainly there are more parallels, but the Turkic influence on this funeral rite seems to be apparent. The ritual attests to the multicultural identity of the Rus, heavily influenced by their Turkic allies. Neither does it seem like ibn-fadlan's account was an entirely isolated case. Ibn-rustah described a similar burial practiced by the Rus. Translations differ. Some say the figure was buried inside of a house, others in a hole as big as a house. Offerings were placed by his side and his favorite slave girl. The girl was selected by a shaman and then buried alive with her master. Various social trends can also be observed within the ritual described by ibn-fadlan. One is the importance of slavery. By giving slaves the option to be sacrificed to their master, they give them an illusion of choice, and to absolve them of their shame, they get to drink, dance, and be tended to by servants of their own. The horrific parts, the rape and the execution, occur inside of the tent, and are drowned out by the men beating their shields. Basically, this rite can be interpreted as a way to demand compliance from the servants. There are other accounts attesting to the manipulation of slaves. Ibn-rustah wrote how, "They treat her slaves well and dress them suitably, because for them they are an article of trade." The burial also attests to the respect for authority and wealth, the name of the king present on the burial plaque, the prominence of ships and travel, of violence, of course, the slave girl being raped and murdered. It is also mentioned in the account how only the master goes to paradise, not the slave girl, in spite of their promises. So despite their illusion of choice to the slaves and demanding their docility, they are ultimately excluded from the ruse elite. Basically, the whole ritual attests to the ruse encountered by the Arabs as being a multicultural upper class of traveling, violent merchants. From accounts of ibn-fadlan and other Arabs, it can also be discerned what the itinerant ruse looked like and how it shaped their identity. "I have never seen more perfect physiques than theirs," wrote ibn-fadlan. "They are like palm trees, are fair and reddish, and do not wear the tunic or the kaftan. The man wears a cloak with which he covers one half of his body, leaving one of his arms uncovered. Every one of them carries an axe, a sword, and a dagger. Their swords are Frankish, with broad, rigid blades. Each man, from the tip of his toes to his neck, is tattooed in dark green pictures." The cloak described by ibn-fadlan bears a striking resemblance to the traditional Germanic garb, which can be seen here on a depiction of Charles the Bald, and likewise from Roman columns. They likely shunned other clothes during the heat, but still had them available. The buried chieftain was described as wearing a kaftan, a sort of coat popular among the Muslims and nomads. Such clothing was even exported and became popular in Scandinavia, indicating the far-flung influence of Turkic culture. In contrast to ibn-fadlan's later musings on hygiene, ibn-rustah wrote how the Rus' clothing was always clean. The men wore gold bracelets and large trousers fastened at the knees. Ibn-fadlan makes mention of Frankish swords. The Franks were renowned blacksmiths and their blades were a common trade good brought by the Rus from the west to the east. Archaeology as well as other accounts confirm the use of these weapons, and interestingly, the Franks would often import Damascus steel to produce them. However, other swords were used as well. Ibn-rustah described the Rus as wielding Sulaimani swords, Solomon's swords, who appears to stem from Khorasan in northern Iran. The dagger was also an important status symbol, imported from the east. In the sagas, a Varangian guardsman returning home to Iceland was described as wielding a dagger in his hand, as is the custom in foreign lands. There is also the presence of the axe. They might have been the long-shafted sort wielded by the Varangians, but it's just as possible that they were of a tomahawk sort unearthed in the region. One such sample was found at Staraya Ladoga. It is a battle axe with a small head and a short shaft. Parts of it are covered in bronze, and it bears the relief of a lion and a griffin. Though obviously Scandinavian in design, it's believed to have been made somewhere in Rus, and has also been influenced by Byzantine art. Of special interest are the tattoos, which in recent years have become heavily associated with Vikings. However, this was not a native Scandinavian, but rather another Turkic custom. There is little evidence of bodily decoration in Old Norse material, but has been observed in nomadic burials. It would have formed an important social function, making the Rus appear more terrifying and commanding. The presence of weapons and a fearsome appearance must have been vital to the Rus. Their own society appears to have been centered around control, controlling both their slaves, their external enemies, robbers, unfriendly nomads, pirates, victims, and of course, internal rivals. Ibn-rustah wrote of their treacherous nature. They never go off alone to relieve themselves, but always with three companions to guard them, sword in hand, for they have little trust in one another. Treachery is endemic, and even a poor man can be envied by a comrade, who will not hesitate to kill him and rob him. Ibn-rustah also wrote of their duels. If one of them has a quarrel with another, it is referred to the ruler, who sells it as he sees fit. If they do not agree with his settlement, he orders the difference to be settled by single combat. The man with the sharpest sword wins. The companions of the two adversaries come out and watch with their arms. The two men fight, and the winner imposes his will on the adversary. This doesn't appear too dissimilar from the Icelandic sagas, most of whom describe blood feuds between various clans, in which duels, assassinations, murder and brawls are as common as pirating and commercial ties. Their sense of violence is also reflected in the Rus' system of inheritance, documented by ibn-rustah. When a child is born, the father presents it with a sword, saying, I shall not leave you any fortune in inheritance, and you will gain nothing apart from what you will obtain with this sword. Aside from personal disputes, the weapons were also used for combat. Ibn-rustah described Rus' tactics. If an enemy makes war against them, they all attack together and never break ranks. They form a single fist against the enemy until they overcome them. They have great stamina and endurance. They never quit the battlefield without having slaughtered their enemy. They take the women and enslave them. They are remarkable for their size, their physique, and their bravery. They fight best on shipboard, not on horseback. In addition, ibn-fadlan described what the women looked like. On their breasts they had a small disc tied around their neck, made of either iron, silver, copper, or gold, in relation to their husband's financial and social worth. Around their necks they also carried hoops of gold and silver. For every 1,000 dirhams that a man possessed, he made another hoop for his wife. These discs are an incredibly common find across Rus and Scandinavia, and the scene attests to the importance of wealth and social stature in Rus society. Ibn-fadlan was not impressed by the hygiene and sexual tendencies of the Rus he met. They would not wash themselves after excreting, urinating, eating, or ejaculating. Though they washed and combed their hairs every morning, they shared a basin between them, in which every man spat and blew his nose. When out and trading, they were always accompanied by beautiful slave girls, whom they would sometimes have intercourse with, in full view of their companions. Ibn-fadlan also described the religious customs of the Rus he met. They erected wooden idols and made sacrifices to them, asking them for boons when conducting their trade, and that their commercial partner wouldn't haggle. These idols were tall pieces of wood, with faces like men and surrounded by small figurines. Such idols have been found in Rus, and it appears similar both to Scandinavian and Slavic practices. Ibn-rustah wrote of the priests present among the Rus. In their lands they have medicine men, who have power comparable to the gods, for they can order the sacrifice of women, men, or horses to their creator. Anything ordered by these medicine men must faithfully be executed. Any medicine man can seize a man or animal, put a rope around his neck, and hang him until he dies, saying that he is a sacrifice to God. These descriptions might have derived from the sentencing of criminals. Ibn-fadlan wrote how thieves were punished among the Rus. If they catch a thief or brigand, they lead him to a great tree, tie a stout rope around his neck, and hang him until he drops to pieces to the wind and the rain. In spite of the description of their violent and treacherous society, ibn-rustah described the Rus as generous hosts, treating their guests well. Strangers who take refuge with them or visit them receive a warm welcome, and no one is allowed to harm them or treat them unjustly. A stranger who has complained or who has suffered an injustice is certain to find protectors and defenders. This hospitality may not have extended to the sickly. Ibn-fadlan wrote the following: if one of them falls ill, the others pitch a tent for him in a place distant from them. They leave him some bread and water, but neither go near nor speak to him. They do not visit him during all the days of his illness, particularly if he is a poor man or a slave. If he recovers and gets well, he comes back to them. If he dies, they burn him. If he is a slave, they leave him where he is, and the dogs and birds of prey devour him. Finally, ibn-fadlan described the king of the Rus. Perhaps this was the mysterious Rus Khagan, discussed in one of my previous videos. One of the customs of the king of the Rus is to have 400 men in his palace, who are the bravest of his companions, men upon whom he can count. These are the men who die when he dies, and allow themselves to be killed for him. Each of them has a slave girl who serves him, washes his head, and prepares everything that he eats or drink. And then there is another slave girl, with whom he sleeps. These 400 men sit below the king's throne, which is immense and encrusted with the finest gems. 40 slave girls destined for his bed sit by him on the throne. Sometimes he has sex with one of them in front of his companions, whom we have just mentioned, without coming down from his throne. When he wants to perform his natural functions, he does so in a basin. If he wants to ride, his horse is led right up to the throne, and he mounts. If he wants to dismount, he has the horse move forward, so that he can get down directly on the throne. He has a lieutenant who commands his troops, fights his enemies, and represents him in his dealings with his subjects. There is next to no information about the origins of the Rus. Written sources are vague, fragmentary, and self-serving. The Rus were only described when they were somehow relevant to their neighbors. We know next to nothing about who the early Rus were. Was it an ethnic term, and who did it encompass exactly? Were it the Slavs, or the Scandinavians, or both, and the Finno-Ugrians? In the eyes of the Arab visitors, who described them most often, the Rus were different from other white northerners. They were a ruling upper class of nomads that traveled by boat instead of horse. They were violent slaveholders with a hierarchy based on wealth, wealth made from the trade of luxury goods and furs. They had extremely close ties to the Turkic peoples of the steppes. They tattooed their bodies in their fashion, merged their burial customs with their own, wore their clothes, and fought alongside them in their armies. The ruler of the Rus, well into the Middle Ages, would be called Khagan. Most telling is the anonymously written Mujmat al-Tawarik, in which the Khazars and the Rus are described as brothers. The name Rus might even stem from the Turkic Urush, those who fight among themselves, indicative of their treacherous and violent society. Indeed, far too often do historians focus on whether the Rus were Scandinavian, while neglecting the obviously Turkic influence. Most likely, the Rus were all of them, and something else. If you enjoy the content I produce, please consider supporting me monetarily by becoming a channel member or patron over on Patreon. You'll find the necessary links in the description box below, in addition to the sources used for writing the video script.